now we're going to shift and we're going to do a town hall. We're going to look ahead in 2022. And so I'd like to bring up Karen Fascio, co-founder of Women in Cloud, to be our moderator of this and talk and sort of drive the conversation. You know, she is a rock star. She's director of global digital channel sales at Microsoft. And I just love you so much, Karen. You're fantastic. So she and her team support hundreds of thousands of technology firms. You know, she is the partner program in and of herself. So I appreciate you, your team, everything you've done to expand economic pathways for women everywhere. You do so much work. So thank you. I'm turning it over to you to moderate that awesome town hall. I'm ready.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Patty.
Power word. What's your power word?
Oh, yeah. My power word this year is integrity.
Integrity. I love it. Thank you.
Yeah. And also, you know, that also covers self-integrity, right? Am I taking care of myself through all of this? I hope you're also doing the same for yourselves. Let's all do this together. So let's set some context here. So, you know, the spirit of a town hall is to gather, to share information, hopefully inspire one another through the stories that we share with each other, check in on how well we are meeting our commitments, our accountabilities, our promises. Are we staying in integrity with the things we committed to and the impact that we want to make collectively? This is also a place for us to exchange ideas and learn from each other. And we're hoping over the next segment that we are able to share some highlights, bring on some experts and folks that are working in the background to support this community at large, and then also gain some learnings, answer questions, and really engage all of us broadly as a community. So with that, why don't I go ahead and bring on Chaitra, president of Women in Cloud, to talk about some of our highlights for the year and lead us to where we're going next.
Hi, Karen. So nice to see you here. Very exciting. Well, we already talked about some of the results. It has been very incredible. But just to kind of recap what we have seen, right, we have three audiences that we serve to really build a very sustainable ecosystem. The first audience that we serve is female, I would say women tech founders building cloud innovation to drive digital transformation in the enterprise ecosystem. So we have solutions, you know, we have focused multiple solutions for them. So we build the cloud accelerator, the Women in Cloud solution marketplace, connected with all the hyperscaler marketplace, Fortune Lunch and Learn series, and also the Get Introduced platform for driving the warm introduction, and also some digital courseware. So everything is like complete for them. So over the last 3 years, you saw like 70 women tech founders graduated from the accelerator, and the total valuation of these companies over $350 million. So, and also yesterday we got informed that five of our portfolio companies joined the winner circle of Microsoft Build for 2030 hackathon. So this was pretty cool. So when we see all the things around the women, they're getting investment, they're getting acquired, they're winning enterprise opportunity. So we know that things are working. All the foundational elements that we needed for them is working. The second ecosystem that we worked on was serving the corporate women and allies. So we focus a lot on helping them lead and influence digital transformations within their organization, and also partnering with female tech founders. So the programs that we focused a lot on is to make sure they have seen, they are showcased, they're engaging, engaging in recruiting diverse talent. So if you remember, like I talked about in the morning, over 1,200 leaders actually stepped in to inspire and influence through warm introductions, meeting them, creating job opportunities, or inviting them into their company. So that has been really amazing. So in 2022, we will actually roll out, it's called as a WIC Lead program. It's a leadership accelerator to help women and allies to build true leadership skills to lead and influence digital transformation initiative, because that is what we learned is a lot of the managers and a lot of the executives are asking for a different type of leadership skill. So we are putting together that accelerator. It's a 6-month and you can go build it. So the third group of ecosystem that we support is women who want to join the tech workforce. So what we learned that the cloud skilling and AI skilling was not very easy. So in partnership with Microsoft and Coursera, we launched the Universal Skilling Scholarship, certification, boot camps, and job fair. And so what we are seeing is we are closer to getting into a year, like we're 9 months into the program. We're already seeing a lot of women are getting graduated, and you'll hear some case studies, and we can help them secure economically fulfilling jobs in the tech. So that's kind of like the three ecosystem. Now, from the political advocacy work, we rolled out our digital advocacy program called Empower Her Access Campaign, where we spotlight leaders to share the perspective on economic access. So we did the proclamation, and we also did the campaign. So what we want to really ensure that the government is engaged to explore sustainable pathways for women to have economic access in the current climate and future. And then building an influential board. So we have Amy Proctexter, our senior vice president from Insight, Gina Fratacangeli, managing director from Accenture. And then we have board of advisors, Lisa Goodman, as well as Gina Jorgensen, Google. They will be joining. So I think from an influential board perspective, we are doing pretty well there. So most of us actually keep asking, how do I get involved? I don't know how to get involved with Women in Cloud. So here is a very, very simple way to think. If you have money, sponsor programs, scholarships, and events. That's an easy way, because we always need money to kind of, you know, to ensure that the programs and the scholarships and events are, you know, keeps creating access and value for our ecosystem. If you have time and you feel like I have time, but I don't know what to do, I would say become an advisor, get yourself engaged and advise at the events or one-on-one. So go to the Get Introduced app and put your profile in, and the warm introductions are facilitated based on what the community needs. Or you can become a speaker, so get your master talk done so that your IP, your intelligence, your framework can probably help one or many of the people to really move forward. But if you have a lot of energy and you say, I want to use my energy, well, become an ally. Make sure you listen, you showcase and promote these women entrepreneurs and leaders and women who want to get into the tech. Showcase them. Use your social engine to drive that, or sponsor organizations to become vendors within your company, because it takes a lot of energy to get a woman to do business with your company. So do that one. So when we think about all the pieces, Karen, that's what we are focusing on, is collective influence, putting all the pieces together and making sure that we become like a more influential community in the world. And I would like to actually invite Kristen Miller with me. So she was part of the accelerator, Karen, if you remember her, and now she's a board of advisor. I think we need to talk about what the recent acquisition of her company Stylize looked like.
Oh, thank you so much for inviting me to be here with all of you. This is my favorite community of human beings. It's great to be part of this. I could probably spend hours talking about the acquisition of Stylize. It's a long journey. I always tell people, and you know this as entrepreneurs, that this is really a marathon, not a sprint. And the same is true for the acquisition process that you go through for your business. So I think with Stylize, there's a couple points that are interesting to share. One is that when we founded Stylize, we decided to become a B2B SaaS platform because that's where our investors that were sort of early investors thought that we had an opportunity, and that's where we knew we could generate revenue immediately. But from a perspective of our passion and what we wanted to deliver for the end customer, we always really saw B2C opportunity. So as we went through our journey and the pandemic hit, we were working very closely with a few retailers at a very strategic basis. So companies like Target and Neiman Marcus, we were working to help them transform their customer experiences, particularly around things like digital styling and digital decor for the home. And when we saw the shift in the market, which for us equated to pipeline getting smaller because enterprise retailers were obviously very cash constrained, we thought, okay, either we need to pivot and go more down market, or we need to look at a strategic acquisition. And so what's interesting about this whole journey is we were in the went through the process of finding an acquirer that really allowed us to continue to fulfill our vision and mission for Stylize. And so amazingly, there was this incredible synergy with Neiman Marcus. We were already working with them at a very strategic level. And we had the opportunity to not only sell our IP and our technology, but also for us as a team to all come over to Neiman Marcus and to continue to fulfill our vision of Stylize in a more B2C way. And so it was an incredible journey. And Women's Cloud was such an integral part of getting us there, just in terms of how we packaged our product and went to market and built relationships with large retailers, investors as well. Certainly one that I, like I said, I could talk for hours about, but happy to answer any other questions that people as they come up. And I don't know if, did I freeze or?
No, you did not, Kristen.
No, you're good. So, Kristen, thank you so much. And a big congratulations to you. You have been an inspiration to us all. And so happy for your success and for continuing to be a part of this community. Really appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It's been great.
Wonderful. Well, with that, we'll go ahead and transition to Erin Northern. Erin has been a big part of our Women in Cloud community, and she has an update on our scholarship program to share.
Yes, thank you, Karen. Hello, everyone. I'm Erin Northern, Partnership Lead for Women in Cloud and Program Manager for our Universal Skilling Initiative. Since May of 2021, Women in Cloud has partnered with Microsoft and Coursera to deliver over 1,000 scholarships globally to those who have been directly affected by the pandemic and those who are looking to upskill and join the tech workforce. We've created access to over 50 countries to participate in our Microsoft Azure Training and Certification Scholarships, where students access self-learning courseware via Coursera, and upon completion, receive a complimentary voucher to take a certification exam in one of the following specializations: Azure Fundamentals, Azure Data, and Azure AI Fundamentals. Our scholarship students are not only focused on their courseware, but they stay actively involved in our community by attending our WIC signature events and connecting with industry leaders who inspire them to take their professional paths to the next level. You may even meet one of them during your time here at the WIC Annual Summit. I'm excited to introduce you to one of our scholarship recipients who's completed two of our specializations and is getting ready to start a new professional chapter. I'd like you to meet Zana Pekmez of Vienna, Austria. Welcome, Zana.
Thank you, Erin. Thank you for giving me voice in this amazing community. My name is Zana Pekmez. I felt really stuck last year in this forum, and this summit really gave me a lot of perspective and helped me unstuck myself, gain insights where I want to take my professional life, where I want to take my career. I really wanted to play in the big league, and I was very dedicated to do whatever it takes and really upskill myself and learn, commit my time to be able to get an offer with an amazing company. And I'm happy to share with you that I'm joining Microsoft in March. And this is going to be a very exciting time for me. I'm very grateful to Women in Cloud for giving me an opportunity and a scholarship to learn, upskill myself, and grab this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Zana, for sharing your experience with us. We look forward to seeing what the future has in store for you. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much. Women in Cloud launched our WIC Fortune 100 initiative early last year, where we partner with Fortune 100 companies to come together and collectively solve gender equity challenges through representation, recruitment, and relationship building. Microsoft, Insight, Teradata, Boeing, Hitachi Solutions, and Accenture are joining us to create access for women, tech founders, and professionals. Leaders from these brands are recognizing the lack of female representation, lack of supplier diversity, and the increased displacement of women held jobs in the tech industry. Our partners have committed to joining our movement and recruiting their colleagues to join as well. The first company to raise their hand and commit to the WIC Fortune 100 initiative was Accenture. Shortly thereafter, WIC was introduced to Accenture Managing Director Patty Burrows. For over 20 years, Patty has proudly partnered with financial services clients to transform their IT organizations through service and platform modernization. She is responsible for technology delivery for financial services clients in the Midwest. Patty specializes in global delivery services, driving operational excellence through large-scale partnerships, and enabling business results through technology transformation. She greatly enjoys being a mentor and career advisor to other Accenture women in technology and plays a leadership role in Accenture's Women in Cloud organization and sits on the board of advisors for Women in Cloud. Welcome, Patty.
Thank you, Erin. Appreciate that a lot. And I'm just thrilled to be here today on behalf of Accenture to talk through our F100 partnership and just some of the value levers that we're seeing across so many aspects of our relationship. So Erin, as you mentioned, I do play two jobs within Accenture. I do sit on the board of advisors for WIC. I also run Accenture's financial services tech practice for the Midwest, which are very different jobs. I do love them both, but there is a similarity there. And I just love to tell this story of the first time I met you guys, where I really understood your mission and the personal motivation behind WIC. And just the fact that you're truly changing the lives for the women across this WIC community. And it just resonated so well with Gina and I, given, you know, Accenture's position on gender parity and driving that access within, you know, our company and for our clients. So as Gina mentioned earlier, we went back internally within Accenture and we just said, who wants to be part of this? And we created a totally optional in your own time committee, and we immediately got 400 people to raise their hands. And here we are 8 months later, and that number has more than doubled. Gina mentioned this as well. We have nearly 900 members that are willing to support this cause and just be involved with Women in Cloud. And that's just in North America. We've got other parts of the globe that are spinning up their own collaboratives around this topic. And we just see that impact continuing to grow, you know, not only in size, but obviously in impact. So I know we've got limited time here. I am a data person. I love metrics. So I want to just quickly highlight a couple of examples of the real value that we've gotten from this relationship in the short time that we've been together. Aside from being part of this great mission, I want to highlight three things. So one is we have had the opportunity to give nearly 100 of our Accenture leaders a platform to share their point of view and experience the knowledge with this community. Chai, you mentioned it. That's in the form of speaking parts at the WIC events like this, mentors for some of the startups, to be an advisor at table breakouts at your conferences, and to folks going through the acceleration programs and some of the certification programs. And panel discussions. So 100 of our leaders got that opportunity, which is good for them, and it's good for the community receiving that experience. The second one is the collaborative has driven access for our own Accenture people. So that almost 900 member internal team that I mentioned has been provided with cloud certification outlets, education, mentoring, really to get more of our Accenture women into the cloud jobs, therefore driving more women in cloud in the industry overall. And the third one, which is a bit of, I would say, icing on cake, we really weren't planning on having the WIC relationship be a huge recruiting channel for us, but we knew that it could be. And we took steps to open channels on our sponsorship page, which you can take a look at. And we've had recruiters at the majority of the WIC events, including one this week. I think it's Friday afternoon. And we also met our recruiting goal for 2021. So just real value, measurable value. You know, we are Accenture, we're a consulting company. If we don't have a metric around it, we don't consider it real. So we're just really excited to share all the great value that this relationship has brought to Accenture and then obviously the community as a whole. And I just want to kind of close with, you know, the impact to me personally. I have made great friendships and relationships and others within the Accenture WIC team have built with you all. It's just been such an honor to be a representative on the board, and I just really look forward to what the future holds for us together.
Patty, for your sponsorship and support, and you know, as Chaitra sort of said in the chat, measurable impact, that speaks louder than anything. And love to have this partnership continue, sort of the cross learning, all the ways to help elevate and keep pushing our impact forward. Thank you.
Thanks, Karen.
All right, I think we're ready to transition now to a conversation around community partnerships. I'd love to bring on stage Frank Valdivieso and Nick Hughes.
Hey, Karen.
Hello, Frank.
Hello.
Happy Wednesday.
Hi, Nick. Well, okay, so I think we're on a little bit of a time crunch, so we're going to keep things nice and brief. The topic is community partnerships. And as you're, before you go into sort of answering my first question, if you could both introduce yourselves to the community, and then we'll dig right into just a few questions on how to think about community partnerships. So Frank, why don't we start with you really quickly?
All right. Thank you, Karen. Again, my name is Frank Valdivieso. I'm the president and CEO of Griffin Consulting. And my full-time job is one of the co-founders of the Black Channel Partner Alliance as well.
Excellent. And Nick?
Yeah, hello, Nick Hughes, founder and CEO of Founders Live. We're a global ecosystem and marketplace for early stage founders. We reach 100,000 people around the world in 26 countries, and really, really happy to have, you know, partnered with WIC for a few years now.
Yes, excellent, wonderful. And Allies, which is wonderful to see more of that representation here within our community as well. So maybe I'll start with you, Frank, first. So community partnerships, how do you describe this? How do you describe sort of the essence of what a community partnership is?
Yeah, I think it's, you know, it kind of goes back to, I love Vinita Gupta's story, right? I mean, all of us are kind of standing on our shoulders, right? And I think that's also reflected in these communities. Again, you know, for the Black Channel Partner Alliance, again, we have benefited greatly from the learnings and kind of the trail that was blazed by Women in Cloud. And again, I think that's the important thing. You know, it's the African proverb, you know, if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. And I think that really plays, that really is what community is about. And I know our community has definitely benefited from all the learnings. Chaitra's been a tremendous ally. Karen, you've been phenomenal in terms of what we've been able to accomplish again. So I think that's something that I'm very proud to be associated with Women in Cloud, how you, this community especially, is unapologetically focused on helping women-owned tech entrepreneurs be successful.
Yeah, excellent. Thank you. Thank you, Frank. So Nick, as someone who is a community founder, community leader, can you sort of describe the why behind why you even took this approach? And you can feel free to describe what your community is as well.
Yeah, you know, I feel like the way that the angle I want to take here is even tying it into, you know, the why that we would want to partner with Women in Cloud and just that two-way street. Really comes down to, you know, I really summed up with like three thoughts, which is first alignment, you know, of values, right? Mm-hmm. And when we look at, you know, we're approached by a number of organizations and, you know, we look out to others, but, you know, are we aligned in our values? And especially from the top leadership, you know, who I usually connect with, especially Chaitra and Raisa and all that. And, you know, winning comes from helping each other. And so is that an aligned value? Secondly, that falls into really our second one is what we call entrepreneurial quality. And, you know, we have a focus on really helping no matter who people look like, where they're from, what country they're from, what language, what gender they identify with, they deserve entrepreneurial, at least opportunity for success. And so with Women in Cloud, you know, that really does fall into really supporting women entrepreneurs, people that identify with that. So very, very important. And thirdly, you know, fun and smart. And that just came to me where I said, you know, each time that we have like a board of advisors call, I'm going to learn something new from Chaitra and the leadership and everyone that's a part of this group. And so we look for learning from our partners as well. And so I think when you combine all that, that's what great partnership looks like, that you're learning, you're helping grow each other, and you're shared in values.
Yeah, agree. Frank, maybe you could talk a little bit about the types of community partnerships you've set up for your organization in connection with Women in Cloud.
Yeah, so one of the first things was the accelerator that we leveraged in our community to kind of provide basically a boot camp, if you will, for our partners that were really trying to accelerate their growth and development in the ecosystem. And so we've had a wonderful partnership, not only with Women in Cloud and leveraging that very amazing asset in terms of the accelerator, but also our tight relationship with the Black Partner Growth Initiative, Microsoft's Black Partner Growth Initiative. And then the other thing is, you know, it can be really lonely as a business owner. And so who do you talk to? I know for me personally, my wife doesn't want to hear about my business issues or problems or struggles that I'm having. And I can't talk to my employees about those issues either. And so again, just like Women in Cloud, you have this community where you can fellowship and engage and learn from other individuals that are going through these challenges that you're facing together. And then another really, really important power of this network, and again, I see it all the time in the platform that Women in Cloud has, there are great mentorship opportunities, right, for you to connect with leaders. And I know that's something that, you know, I personally have not taken advantage of, but it's something that's here, and it can be extremely valuable for you as you're growing, and as though, you know, take advantage of when you think you're alone. There is a platform and there is a way for you to engage with others that can help you. And I think that's probably one of the most underutilized aspects of a lot of communities. And I'd say, you know, engage with this community. Again, this event here over the next couple of days, you're going to have opportunities to meet with and see individuals who are either where you want to be or where you've been, if you will. And so take advantage of that. That to me is probably one of the most powerful aspects of not only this community, but the community we're trying to build for the Black Channel Partner Alliance.
Yeah, I love that. Nick, how about you? I know you've also been creating some connecting points with Women in Cloud and the work you're doing within your community.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, what Frank said, there's a ton of stuff there just from engaging with the community and you know, as Founders Live is its own, you know, kind of community globally as well, trading there, supporting. So, you know, thank you, Frank. And what I would touch on for what we do is, look, Founders Live is a massive collection of a lot of localized events that are really pitch competitions. We highlight and support early stage startups and founders. And, you know, there's numerous times where, whether it's Seattle or other cities, other types of events that we're reaching into the Women in Cloud community saying, hey, is there anyone that would want to apply and actually pitch at our events? So what's great is, you know, it's something that, not to say it's selfish, but, you know, we're looking to highlight, you know, startups and founders, and, you know, so we can, you know, reach out and ask the Women in Cloud community, is there any interested entrepreneurs that want to, you know, jump on stage this month, either in, you know, Seattle or other cities around the country and the world. So that really seems to be one of the best things, is we can put a shining light on these entrepreneurs, that just give them that next opportunity for exposure, pitch at our events, and hopefully move forward. And so that's definitely one. And again, I'm going to highlight, you know, Chaitra and the leadership in forming even just a tighter, you know, advisory community, that a tremendous amount of partnership is happening through that smaller group that is, you know, just, it's an amazing kind of help each other group, as well as we're helping Women in Cloud. So it's been great.
Yeah, I think that you're both saying something really powerful. I mean, and I hope what everyone's sort of hearing here is this power of communities. It's communities of communities. And we're all intersecting while we all have sort of a distinct position in terms of how we support our constituents at large.
Yep.
And that, you know, through this, we're creating, I like to use the word socket. Like, it's a socket that you can plug into for, you know, opportunities, access points, trying things, and creating just a space of being able to connect with each other and learning.
Well,
yeah,
I just want to kind of share, like, we all have our own audiences, right? And so if we're all able to come together and highlight each other in front of our own audiences, you know, that's how we rise the tide. So, yes.
With you. Absolutely. So, you know, you're both very practiced in the community space, not only in participating, but also in leading. What's the, I'd like to kind of get to the takeaway, which is advice on how to make the most of being a part of a community.
Frank.
Yeah, I'd say it's about engagement. These events are critical, I think, and I love that metaphor of the socket, right? Because now I'm thinking about, so how do you plug in? And I think you've got opportunities across the Microsoft ecosystem, a number of different ways to kind of engage. Obviously, Women in Cloud, for those of you, for all the women entrepreneurs out there on this call today, this is your socket. You could plug into this community and get a lot of value out of it. So I think it's about plugging in to that community, taking advantage of these opportunities to learn from, engage with one another, meet with like-minded individuals. I also challenge you and ask you to also think about finding an accountability partner, right? Basically finding someone who can share this journey, keeping you guys, keeping one another focused and pushing each other forward. So I think that would be what I'd say as a takeaway. Find someone that you can engage with, create an accountability group, and stick together and rise together, if you will.
Fantastic. How about you, Nick?
Yeah. Yeah, what came to mind right now was almost the kind of give-get thing, in the sense that, you know, ask yourself, what can I offer? And everyone, you all here, we can all offer something. And so what can you offer? Expertise, just an ear, a perspective, an introduction, you know, capital, whatever. Think about that. And then what do you need? And then after you identify those, you know, take some risks of engaging, like Frank said, and, you know, go, you know, check out events like this, or now we're going to get back into in-person, hopefully. So what sort of community organizations and events do you want to engage with? And take some risks to go back out there and see how you can help people. It's, you know, that's where we're at now, is just starting to get back into that mode.
Yeah, with you. Yes, thank you. But both excellent takeaways. It's, you know, it is about, you can make the most out of this. It's how you engage. It's how you participate. It's whether it's you're an access point or you're a seeker of access. Wonderful. Thank you both. So I think at this point, we're here to open up the panel to others who have presented over the last hour, if we could bring folks on stage. And we want to answer some questions that have come from our community. Again, community forum, town hall forum, lots of people who can answer questions from within the chat to each other, as well as to our esteemed panelists. All right. So let me start with this general question. So there's basically a couple of themes that came in from an earlier survey that we asked the community at large to respond to. Some are related with career tips. Some are related to representation and DE&I, all the way into how to address challenges that we see are fairly unique to women. So I'll ask a couple of questions and see if I can direct them to those of you on the panel who can best answer. And feel free, if any of you have answers to add, to do so. So let's start with career. So starting a career in the tech industry and how a community like Women in Cloud can assist. So one of the questions is, you know, Is there an opportunity for women in cloud to train me on how to stand out in the tech environment, especially when I'm not as confident in cloud computing? And I was wondering, Chaitra, maybe you could start off with that. And Frank, if you have any anything to add just from your perspective as a professional in cloud.
Sure. So Karen, most of the people fear cloud and then an AI, and they are like, I don't know where to start. I usually say is, if you're new, coming out of college, you need to have a basic fundamental skilling on cloud. So go take the class. If you, you can go and, you know, go on LinkedIn, there are courses. If you go on, you know, Microsoft, Google, and Amazon and others, you have those free trainings. But what employers are looking for is fundamentals where you're certified. That means you know the language of how the cloud works. So that's the first thing. The second thing is you need to have a network around you, because then that is the fastest way, because you if you put the resume there, we don't know if it's going to be even searched. So you need to have a network who's actually sharing the resume to the right person. So when you get those two right, and then you know which platform you want to use, which cloud platform you want to really become really good at. I recommend Azure because we work with Azure team a lot and it's easy to use. So if you're thinking about the cloud platform, then pick that, and that will give you a very good idea of the companies who are using that infrastructure, so that when you get skilled, it's easy to create, it's easy to find the job. So like according to Monster, 20% of the all the top jobs that are out there is driven through cloud and AI in 2021. So when you think about it, if you get that triangle right, it's very easy. So from Women in Cloud, yes, we do have scholarship, we have the certification, you have the network, and you also have the Fortune brands ready to absorb you if you are in the right space.
Yeah, the thing I'll add to that, Karen, is this is a term that a dear friend of ours, Nashatan Dawani, we use all the time, is cheat codes. So that's what the community can provide you with, right? So I'll give you an example. You know, I've been a Microsoft partner for over 8 years and really floundered through that. It's a big ecosystem. There's a lot of resources that are available to you, and really didn't know how to navigate the system. But by being able to basically interface and interact with this community, learned about, hey, this is where you need, these are some resources that you need to leverage, Solution Workspace, CED. And I only learned that through participating in communities like this. And so I think another real superpower of this community is helping to accelerate your growth as a partner, right? Don't go alone, go with the community. So there are lots of tremendous resources, not only in terms of educational content, but individuals that can guide you in the right direction so that you're not beating your wall. If you feel like you've kind of hit a brick wall, I am sure there are resources or individuals that have already busted or kicked that door down or basically blown that wall away that can really help to advance you. So for me, that's been something that's been extremely powerful, and leveraging the power of community is really to help advance and accelerate my company personally tenfold, if you will.
Thank you. Thank you both. So there's also a question coming that was raised from folks that are building SaaS solutions. And so I'm hoping to engage Nick and Kristen in this question, which is about how to set yourself up well as a female entrepreneur or entrepreneur of color for VC. And so, Kristen, I don't know if you wanted to sort of get started on that, and then Nick will hand over to you.
Yeah, I think this is another one of those questions that I could probably talk for hours about. So I won't do that, I promise. But I think the first thing I would say is understand how that ecosystem works. VCs are motivated in very specific ways, and they evaluate companies through kind of a simple formula, right? You know, like understanding your team, understanding your marketplace, understanding your solution. It's kind of this three-legged stool. And I think really understanding that and then sort of the economics of how that whole industry works is gonna go such a long way to getting you the success that you wanna see. And then just acknowledging that for better or worse, sometimes we need to work a little bit harder. So, you know, do your homework, find the right connections in, and be persistent, don't give up. And realize too that any investor relationship, it's a marriage of sorts, it's two ways. So it's, you know, should be mutually beneficial. And it's as much about, is that VC the right VC for you and your business as it is, you know, the other direction. So bear that in mind too, and don't be intimidated by that.
Good. Yeah. What I'll add is, you know, you might've heard this before, but you know, VCs and investors, they invest in lines, not dots. What that means is a dot is one interaction. And typically, you know, a line is 3, 4, 5 dots together. And that basically means it takes time to establish that relationship, as well as establish your data points with that one person. And, you know, if you're a founder that's like, ooh, I'm just gonna hopefully have one meeting with this investor and they're gonna write a check, that's not the way it works. And it doesn't matter who you are, what you look like, these are all applied to everyone. And so I would suggest, you know, really doing that homework, understanding that it's a dots together that is paving your growth. And that's going to take time. And then obviously establish a good connection and rapport with those individuals. And, you know, hopefully over time, you've established a good, strong connection. And hopefully an investment comes from that.
You know, all of you as business leaders, you know, getting the best talent, right? Having the best talent, curating, developing, investing in is important. But then we also have this high interest in making sure we have diverse talent, just so we can tap into the power of that. And some questions that came in through the survey, and there's actually one in the chat as well, is the complexity and the difficulty in finding great talent from diverse populations. Do you have any suggestions or learnings to share with the audience? And maybe I'll just open it up to whoever would like to take that first.
Yeah, I can start. So a couple of things obvious is, there are some non-traditional pathways that you can take advantage of, if you will. So for example, we've been leveraging apprenticeships in our company to basically engage with candidates that, you know, are not going to go traditional. You're not going to find them in traditional sources or traditional pools, if you will. And that's been very, very effective for us. The other thing is, I know Lauren's on the call here, Lauren Anderson, her firm kind of focuses on finding applicants, diverse applicants. So there are recruiting companies that actually focus in finding candidates in that space. So I'd say thinking non-traditionally, so don't necessarily go back to the typical sources. Also look around the table and just say, who's not here, right? Who's not here? And then put together a recruitment plan to attract those individuals to the organization.
Great advice. I believe that completely. One more comment. Nick, did you want to add something to that?
Yeah, I think what came to mind was, and I'm, you know, reading the question here, is maybe as organizations being a bit more mindful around how we're advertising or putting out the job description or opportunity, just being aware of the words that we're using and, you know, actually who we're calling out to. I'm just going to feel uncomfortable, but if you want to increase the amount of, for instance, you know, women or females on this team, you know, at some point you got to be intentional on that and, you know, using words. And so I think that that's a thought that came to mind there.
Excellent.
Yeah, and awesome. Karen, one thing that I can add is what I suggest people to do is do a representation view across all the pieces from the leadership, right? From the board, from the executive, from the employee, the community, and the supplier channel. That gives you a very good representation. Are we representing the right people in the right place? If you don't see diverse people, you're not attracting a whole set of talent there. And that would be the first way to visually look at it. So we have a lot of work to do, or we are doing really well. Even for the summit, everything we had to look for. Are we representing the youth? Are we representing the people who are in the, you know, the seniors? Are we representing everyone? Are we representing race, the gender? So, but it is work. It doesn't happen automatically. You have to work at it.
Excellent. All right. Well, I think we are at the close of our session. Thank you, everyone, for all of your advice, your insights, and your support. Really appreciate it from the leadership team at Women in Cloud and certainly from the community at large. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.